think we choose to be born? Or are we fitted to the times we're born into? We begin with equality. That's the origin, isn't it? That's justice.
See, we've shown that a people can endure awful sacrifice and yet cohere.
South Africa, I think it was in 1970, I'd been asked by the students at the English University at Durban to give a lecture on academic freedom, and after it, two of them took me along to the students, the African students' hostel for the medical school. And I'd never heard of him before that, and I don't suppose many people had at that time. And I found him one of the most interesting young men I've ever met in my life, straight away. And had an astonishing conversation with him, which at once convinced me that here was somebody who was going to mean something. He said to me, mind you, there's got to be a white contribution too. We're not the only people in this country. And I thought, when I heard that, I thought, now that's one of the most encouraging remarks I've heard. And I must say, it didn't surprise me altogether to find that he came from Africa.
That charisma actually referred to some superhuman qualities of individuals, I would say almost semi-gods, who have some very personal and exclusive relationship to God, and therefore, like any other human beings, they kind of can talk to God, and then they can interpret God's will to the people. These were charismatic leaders.
Yeah, oh, hi. Steve Biko? Are you Steve Biko?
I am.
Well, he was the special hero of the young black South African political activists. He articulated their philosophy for them. He was the founder of four movements which had a special bearing on their problems. And he was the, you might say, the spiritual head of them all and the advisor and guide of these movements. So he occupied a very special place. At the age of 30, he was just young enough to be acknowledged as the leader of the youth and just mature enough to be able to do so wisely.
It was good of you to come, Mr. Woods. I wanted to meet you for a long time.
We see a completely non-racial society. We don't believe, for instance, in the so-called guarantees for minority rights, because guaranteeing minority rights implies the recognition of portions of the community on a race basis. We believe that in our country there shall be no minority, there shall be no majority, there shall just be people. And those people will have the same status before the law, and they will have the same political rights before the law. So in a sense, it will be a completely non-racial egalitarian society.
But will the vast number of blacks, after all their experiences, yes, be able to live a life without giving vent to feelings of revenge, of...
Yes, we believe it is the duty of the vanguard political movement which brings about change to educate people's outlooks. I mean, in the same way that blacks have never lived in a socialist economic system, they're going to live, to learn to live in one. In the same way that they've always lived in a racially divided society, they've got to learn to live in a non-racial society.
There's no greater force in this whole world than an idea whose time has arrived. An idea whose time has arrived. And that idea, ladies and gentlemen, is black consciousness, which is going to free the black man from the shackles of white imperialism, white slavery, white oppression.
In Steve's case, I knew he would never harm himself physically in there. He had given me to understand quite plainly that if he was detained and he died in detention, and it was alleged that he had done anything which brought about his death, such as hanging, you know, this is the one often given out, cutting himself, something, or suffocating himself, pillow, anything like that, or starvation, then I would know it wasn't true. Well, it's now nearly 2 weeks since we had the news, and it's still extremely hard to believe that this has happened. Personally, it seems hard to accept that we won't see him again. And frankly, I don't know when all the activity of trying to find out who's responsible for it is over, when the inquest is over and such prosecutions as follow according to what's indicated by the inquest, I frankly don't know how my wife and I are going to adjust after that. At the moment, we kept very busy with involvement in this process. But after that, we'll have to face up to the fact that he isn't there for us to see anymore.
Well, even if it were he was on hunger strike, I don't think it would have killed him. Yes, especially, you know, quoting the number of days they say he was refusing food, I don't think that would have killed him. Unless they were giving him bad food. I know he doesn't like bad food, of course. But I don't think that would have killed him.
Was he a strong man?
Very much strong, healthy. He was never ill, you know, seriously, except for one illness he had, some pneumonia. And after that, he was just strong. He has been a strong man, really.
With so many people dead or in detention, do you ever feel like giving up?
Well, we do expect, you know, during a struggle, obviously, we expect anything, you know, anything can happen. But I just can't understand why people, you know, are not brought before court if they are found guilty or they are charged. Because, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, these detentions and, you know, banning orders, they don't mean anything. I mean, if a man is found guilty or if a man, they find that the man is guilty of some offense, he must be brought before a court of law.
The choice was mine and mine completely. I could have any prize that I desired. I could burn with the splendor of the brightest fire, or else I could choose time. Remember, I was very young then, and a year was forever and a day. So what use could 50, 60, 70 be? I saw the lights and I was on my way. And how I lived, how they shone, but how soon the lights were gone.
God. Black consciousness is an attitude of the mind and a way of life. The most positive call to emanate from the black world in a long time. Its essence is the realization by the black man of the need to rally together with his brothers around the causes of their oppression and to operate as a group to rid themselves of the shackles that bind them to perpetual servitude. We must also remember that the most powerful weapon in the arsenal of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. It is our duty, therefore, to give Africa a more human face, a more dignified face, and a more beautiful face. A face that we can call our own. A face that we can be proud of. A face that is as beautiful as this land is. And is as beautiful as we are.